All right, guys, how are you guys doing? I'm going to try to go through these papers here. The lighting in here is not all that great, so I'm hoping I can read some of my notes. But these are the notes and some of the things that I did while I was incarcerated for the last 7 nights and 6 days. And I want to show you kind of what I went through. And what my mental state was when I was in jail. I am in jail under false allegations, under a false, modification, divorce. I had a settlement agreement that we agreed to, and, 8 months after, my attorney was no longer on the case, my husband filed a flat out lie in order to gain full custody and control of my child. And, he's been trying ever since and, won't leave me alone. So, you know, I am doing the best I can with what I've got, and I'm representing myself in court. It has been a battle, and I am struggling, mentally, emotionally, financially, now. And when I say I didn't get anything out of my divorce, it's because of the modification. When I say there's false allegations, it's the modification. The settlement agreement is what we had and what we agreed to. It was the best for our child. And so everything else has been made up in a lie to gain control and continue the abuse that I was in my marriage for the last 13, 14 years now. And so, you know, I can't stop it. And all I can do is thank God for the marriage that I had when I had it. I need to continue to keep my focus on doing what God has commanded me to do in His Word. And I need to make that conscious decision myself to follow Jesus Christ, no matter what my ex-spouse does. And so, while I was sitting there, you know, in jail, I'm thinking, why am I here? I haven't ever done anything wrong. And I am a rule follower. The legal battles has put me in so much distress and hardship that I can't do anything. I can't make a move anymore. I will lose my apartment. I will lose my job. I will lose everything for me and my children and my granddaughter or anyone else that is in my family if this continues. And so I want to definitely just maintain the stability that I can. And so this is the thought process of what I've had to go through. And I got a lot of encouragement while I was in jail this time around, a lot of books that have helped and some Bible study guides. And I want to go over those with you and kind of share with you what I read and what my thought process was during this journey. So, first of all, on Thursday night, the pastor came up. There's two women who came up to our pod and was giving us these folders, and they gave us a Bible. And so I got those. They also gave us a track. And so the track says, God loves you and promises that you can know now for sure that you are going to heaven. These things that I have written unto you that believe on my name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. 1 John 5:13. So I have believed on Jesus Christ as the Son of God back when I was 5 years old. I was saved and I accepted Him. I repented of my sins. And, you know, my sin back then was very, very little of a sin, but I recognized it as a sin. And it doesn't mean that I haven't sinned since. I all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. But so why isn't going to heaven automatic? It says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God. So your sins have hid his face from you, and he will not hear you. Isaiah 59:2. So we don't want to be living in sin. We want to follow God's commandments. You know, we want to repent of those sins. You know, that's one of the first things that we need to do is admit that we're a sinner and repent of those sins. You know, ask for forgiveness. And we don't want to be in this world. We don't want to be leaving our families, and we don't want to be divorced. We don't want to be separated from our spouses. We want to be united in marriage and commitment. The times that we're living in right now, we want to have a God-filled and God-fearing family. And we need to have a husband in our family and our wife in our family. And we need to have that bond, that unity with Jesus Christ in a marriage. And we need to be able to teach our kids. Our family, our immediate family, is our first witness. You know, God joined a man and a woman together. He's to leave his mother and father and join with his wife and become one with her. And we need to set that example for our children. You know, God hates divorce. He doesn't want adultery, and he doesn't want sin. He doesn't want you living together. He doesn't want you to commit crimes. He doesn't want you to lie, cheat, steal. He doesn't want you to commit murder. These are the commandments. So when you stand before God and he asks you if you've ever broken any of the 10 commandments, how are you going to plead, innocent or guilty? Commandment number 9, thou shalt not bear false witness. So that means you shall not lie. Have you ever told a lie? Commandment number 8, thou shalt not steal. Have you ever taken something, anything, without owner's permission or knowledge? Commandment number 7, thou shalt not commit adultery. Jesus said, if you look at a person with lust and you lust after them, you commit adultery. And then you have committed even in your heart if you don't act out on it physically. Have you ever looked at someone with impure thoughts? You know, have you ever lived with a boyfriend or a girlfriend before you were married? It's sin. The problem, we are all guilty of breaking God's law, and our sin separates us from God. The Bible says, for we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. And then there's a little diagram. It says, people are sinful over here. God is holy over here. And then it says, do you know what the penalty for breaking God's law is? And all liars shall have their part in the lake, which burneth with fire and brimstone, Revelation 21:8. No thieves shall inherit the kingdom of God, 1 Corinthians 6:10. For the wages of sin is death, Romans 6:23. God gave us free will and freedom of choice. He did not make us as robots to automatically love and obey him. We have to choose to disobey God and go our own way willfully each day. So it says no bridges reaches God except for one. And then there's another diagram. It says people who are sinful over here. Then there's a bridge. It says good works, religion, morality, philosophy. So there's a bridge. When you are following God's commandments and his laws, it gives you that bridge over to your holy God over here. Our attempts to reach God, people have tried in many ways to bridge the gap between themselves and God. The Bible says, there is a way which seemeth right unto man, but the end, therefore, are the ways of death. Proverbs 14:12. This is one of my verses that my husband and I had learned in discipleship. For by grace you are saved through faith, not of yourselves, for it is a gift from God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians 2:8-9. So that's that side. Then it says, God's bridge, the cross, Jesus Christ died on the cross, was buried, and rose again from the grave. He paid the penalty for our sin and bridged the gap between God and people. The Bible says, for there is one God, one mediator between God and man, and the man Christ Jesus. 1 Timothy 2:5. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, and just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. 1 Peter 3:18. But God commandeth his love toward us, that in while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Romans 6:23. So God has provided the only way that each person must make a choice. So you got the sinful way, but God gives you that bridge over to the holy God. I love this. It says, where are you? Are you over here? Are you in the middle? Or are you over here? Our response, receive Christ. We must trust Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and receive him by personal invitation. The Bible says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man heareth my voice and open the door, I will come in with him, and I will sleep with him, and I will be with him, and him with me. Revelation 3:20. But as many as received him, to them who gave him power to become the sons of God, even to them that believeth on his name. John 1:12. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, and shalt believe with thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Romans 10:9. You cannot be confessing that you're a Christian or go to church regularly saying that you're a Christian and then living in this world, living in sin. And, you know, I think that's where we have to realize that we are sinners, is when we are intentionally, knowingly saying that we're Christian on Sunday mornings when the doors are open, but yet we are taking each other to court, or we are lying, or we are cheating, or we're sleeping around, or we are divorcing our families and causing that separation and the hardship that comes with all that. You know, when I was in jail, I was around all these women who couldn't wait to get out of jail because they wanted to turn around and go get high again, or go get on drugs again, or sleep around. And I was giving my testimony in there, and they were like, well, you need to find yourself a sugar daddy, a guy who's just gonna make the other guy jealous, or you need to do this, or you need to do that. And as a Christian, I was like, I can't do those things, you guys. I can't leave my marriage. I can't lie or cheat or steal, because God has commanded me to not do those things. And as a Christian believer, what kind of example am I going to set for those around me, especially in jail, or my children, if they see me acting as the world? That makes me no better than anyone else in the world. And I need to show that God lives in me, in my decisions that I make. And so I need to be faithful to my relationship, my marriage covenant with Jesus Christ. And so God has made all those answers to the questions I have in my life very, very clear in his word. So it says here on how you can receive Jesus Christ in your life. Number one, admit that you are in need, that you are a sinner. Number two, be willing to turn from your sins. So you need to repent of your sins. Number three, believe that Jesus Christ died for you and only you on that cross, that he was buried and he rose from the grave. Amen. And then number four, through prayer, invite Jesus Christ to come in and control your life through the Holy Spirit. Receive him as Lord and Savior. And then it says the sinner's prayer. How do you pray this? You say, dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I have deserved to be punished for my sins. I believe that you love me and you died on the cross for me. You were buried. You rose from the dead 3 days later. Please forgive me. I want to turn from my wicked ways and my sins. I place my faith in you and as my only hope and salvation. I now invite you into my heart and my life. Dear God, please save me, Lord Jesus. Amen. And, you know, I did say that prayer in jail again, even though I am already a Christian. And others will know you by your fruit. How do you act? You know, if I am sitting there cussing out the people who have put me in jail, then I'm not setting a good example for those people that are in jail who are seeing, you know, how I'm acting, if I'm saying I'm a Christian. So I need to make sure that I am praying for those people who have put me in jail. I need to pray for salvation. I need to pray for them to repent of their sins and follow Jesus Christ. Because ultimately, when someone that you love is lying, cheating, and they want to put you in jail, it's very, very difficult, but you're going to have to forgive them. You know, and this is something that I will talk about here in a little bit more on some of my notes that I said, but forgiveness was a big thing that God just really laid on my heart, really heavy while I was in jail this time around, and quit saying the things that I've been saying about asking God, you know, to pray for me. I've been praying for me. And God really, really laid upon my heart, I need to pray for those who have hurt me. And I need to forgive, you know, ultimately. And don't hold that anger in, even though the abuse and the harassment and the false allegations continue. I need to move forward with forgiveness in my life. And so God really laid that on my heart, and that's something personal that I'm going through. It's a grieving process when you love your family, you love your husband, you love your children, and you are being torn apart and separated from them. You do get angry. And when I went through my divorce care classes, that was one of the things is before you can move on with your life, you need to ask for forgiveness of the things that you have done that might have been wrong in your relationship, in your marriage, as you're getting divorced. But you also need to forgive the other person for what they've done to hurt you. And, you know, sometimes people hurt people for, you know, intentionally. And some people hurt people inattentionally. And we need to let them know that they hurt us. And that's one way for us to forgive them, is to say, hey, you have hurt me. And another thing is to be a witness, you know, be an example, set your life up to do what God has commanded you to do as a Christian, and let those people who are against you continue to do what they're doing. And you just stand strong on the firm foundation of God, and He will protect you, and He will give you the love you need. And He won't abandon you, and He will take care of you. And so with that, as a Christian, I know that God always has provided. God has never let me down. And so this is what I reflected on while I was in jail. It says here, God's assurance, His word. If you prayed this prayer, the Bible says, for whosoever call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Romans 10:13. Did you sincerely ask Jesus Christ to come into your life? Well, where is He now? And what has He given to you? The Bible says, if you pray this prayer, the Bible says that this is the promise that He hath promised us, even eternal life. 1 John 2:25. By receiving Christ, you are born into His family through the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit, who indwells every believer. This is called regeneration, or a new birth. This is just the beginning of a wonderful new life in Christ Jesus. To deepen this relationship, you should read your Bible every day and get to know Christ better. You know, that's how we grow in our marriages and our relationship with others, is to get to know each other intimately, get to know each other and trust each other and love on each other. And I can tell you, the 10 years of my marriage, I did a great job of loving my spouse. I've done everything I can possibly to show him that I loved him. It was never good enough because he never loved me. So I tried so hard to love him and to show him I loved him. And you know, there was a lot of finger pointing, you know, in our marriage, and it was part of the abuse I had to go through. And so number two, talk to God in prayer every day. Number three, tell others about Christ. Number four, worship, fellowship, and serve with other Christians in a church where Christ is preached and the Bible is taught. Number five, as Christ's representative in a needy world, demonstrate your new life by your love and concern for others. So, and then there's a map and the worship times of the church that left this devotional. And so they were passing this out to the inmates. And I think that this is a really good way of simplifying. How do you get help? How do you get repentive of your sins? And how do you make that change in your life as an inmate, as a criminal? And so I read that. And I did get this Bible, like I said, Freedom Behind Bars. I'm going to make another video separate talking about this. I also received this devotional, Jesus Calling. I am going to make a separate video on that. I can talk real quick about this folder that I got, because a lot of it was private information, my jail records. I got these large print word finds, and a friend gave me this extra one that I didn't get done, but I did get the word find in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 of them that I got finished. I did a lot of these word search, and it just kept my mind going. It, you know, basic things. This is not biblical, but it's just large print, and it's a word find, and it just passed the time while I was sitting in jail quite a bit for me. And I was very, very thankful to have that. As I was sitting there in jail, I just kept writing down all these different songs that was going through my head. And your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. I sang that song in my head over and over again. And I wrote down all these songs. In my Father's eyes, my Father's eyes, love of understanding, seeking every pain. So that was an Amy Grant song back in the 80s. I sang that song. And then Sandy Patty songs, We Shall Behold Him, when we see him face to face in all of his glory. And just trying to remember and remind myself that Jesus is coming soon. So I would sing, Jesus is coming back, Jesus is coming back. And then, like a bride waiting for her groom, we the church are waiting for you. You know, Lord Jesus, come. And then I would sing, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. And amazing grace, how sweet that sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. This is one song I used to sing as a little girl. As the deer panteth forth the water, so my soul longeth after thee. And then, Jesus, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Lord of all, Emmanuel, God is with us. Blessed Redeemer, Lord of all. And this is the air I breathe. Holy Spirit living in me. And then Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty One, Lord of Hosts. He is the Prince of Peace, Mighty God, Holy One. Emmanuel, Emmanuel. And great is your faithfulness, great is your faithfulness. Morning by morning, your mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Lord, unto thee. And then I would sing, Blessed is the name of the Lord. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Blessed is the name of the Lord Most High. And then, of course, I said in my last video, Jesus loves me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. And that just reminds me of scripture is by song and by singing. And so I did write these down so I could share these with you. These are the songs I replayed over and over and over in my head. And it was probably mid half week before I started writing those songs down. But that's how I entertained myself, was by writing down my feelings and my thoughts and what I was dealing with at that time. And so I just want to share with you, you know, what's going on in my little head. They gave me a couple Bible verses on this orange paper. It says, Lord God, it was you who set the boundaries of the earth. You made both summer and winter. Psalm 74:17. And then, I got another one somewhere in here. And then I had one that says, the effective prayer of righteous man can accomplish much. James 5:16. I got some puzzles. This is I Am the Way, John 14:6. There is only one way to know God. Do you know the way? Start with the first letter on the grid. Write every other letter in the lines below. You'll need to go through it. I didn't even do this because I already knew what it said. It says, Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father except for through me. So I already knew that verse. That was easy. I also knew this side, a place for you, John 14:2. Jesus says, we will always be with him in a place made especially for us. And it says, use the code to decipher just what Jesus said. And I already knew this. Like I said, in my Father's house, there are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And so, you know, Jesus is coming back. Jesus is coming back. Amen. So I'm excited for that. Here's a couple more word finds and some just little things that they gave us to doodle on, and mazes, and Sakoto page to do, some more word finds, word roundup game. And so that kept me busy. I want to thank God a lot for this stuff that I got in my church's time, and with the pastors and stuff that came to visit us in our pod. And then we got some more of these activities. It was Dallas, Fort Worth, Nashville, San Antonio, Chicago, Oklahoma City, Tulsa, Bluegrass Country Worksheet, the Ozarks, Mammoth Cave National Park, St. Louis Arch. So those are just busy pages to keep us busy and keep time going. And then we got this Bible study. It talks about God's love and love for others. Smile. Recent study I read concluded that smiling can be good for your health. Researchers show that smiling slows down the heart and reduces stress, which is great because I was under duress while I was in jail. But smiling isn't good for you. A genuine smile blesses those on receiving end as well. Without saying a word, it can tell others that you like them and that you're pleased with them. A smile can hug someone without love, without even giving them the slightest touch. Life does not always give us a reason to smile, but when we see a heartfelt smile on a child's face or through age wrinkles, our hearts are encouraged. Smiles are also a hint of the image of God in us. An ancient blessing recorded in the book of Numbers, we get an indication that God smiles. The Lord makes his face shine upon you, be gracious upon you, and Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Numbers 6:25 and 26. Those words are a Hebrew idiom for the favor of God on a person's life, asking God to smile on his children. So today, remember that you are loved by God and that he is pleased to be gracious to you and shine his face upon you. Lord, may my life be so pleasing to you that you smile and shine your face on me. As you graciously smile on my life, may I find someone today who I can share your love through a smile. A smile can be a message of cheer from God to a needy soul. And I did that while I was in jail. And then, so that was that one. And then on the other side, it says, just as I am, good memories flooded my mind as I sat in a concert. The group's leader had just introduced the song they were about to sing, Just As I Am. Just as I am without a one plea. I remember how to come forward while we sang that song, indicating they would like to receive the forgiveness that Christ offers for their sins. But the leader of the musical group at the concert suggested another occasion that we might sing this song. He commanded that he likes to think that when he dies and goes to meet the Lord one day, he will sing in thanks to him, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come, I come. So years before writing this song, Charlotte Elliott asked a minister how she might find the Lord. He told her, just come to him as you are. Jesus did, and later, during a discouraging time of illness, she wrote this hymn about the day she came to Christ and he forgave her sin. In his word, the Lord encourages us to seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon his name while he is near, Isaiah 55:6. He calls out to our hearts, everyone who thirsts comes to the water, incline your ear and come to me, hear and your soul shall live. Because of Jesus' death and resurrection, we can come to him right now, and one day we will go to eternity to be with him forever. Just as I am, I come. So it says, let him who thirsts come, whoever desires him, take up the water of life freely. Revelation 22:17. So, that was just encouraging scripture there. I also have a lot of Bible studies. I am going to add that to my Bible when I do that video for you guys. I got on the law library while I was in jail, and I learned about my First Amendment right is the right to criticize the government or state officials. You know, the reason why I can say what I'm going to say is because my First Amendment right. You all have a right to say what you want to say, and you can exercise your First Amendment right, and you can make your own YouTube channel. So, you know, find something that you enjoy doing and stand up for your faith, stand up for what you believe in, and make your own videos. And if you don't like what I have to say, then get off my videos. So I am exercising my First Amendment right, and I definitely want to stand up for what's right and what's commanded by God. Being separated from your children and work has caused a substantial financial and emotional burden on both mother and child. So I am documenting all the distress, the hardship I'm under. And I looked up Missouri law while I was there on the law library there in the jail. And, you know, there is no person shall be imprisoned for debt except for non-payment of fines and penalties imposed by law. This is Missouri law S11, imprisonment for debt. So that is something that I definitely want to keep and I want to utilize is my constitutional rights and my Missouri laws because I live in the state of Missouri. So just thought I would share that with you. And, you know, I kind of made some documentation of when I get out, what am I going to do? You know, what does God want me to do? I wrote down, I feel worthless and helpless and I need to have God show me and guide me what he wants me to do in my life as a Christian. And so I kind of wrote some of that stuff down. I also wrote a letter to my boys as I was sitting there in jail. And I'm not going to share this letter with you. This is personal. But, you know, I did write my boys a front and a back page letter. And so, again, here's another puzzle. It was connect the dots, and I did that, and then I colored it a little bit with my little tiny pencil that I had. And then rest of it is just plain notebook paper that I never used up, so I can keep some of that for notes. And then I wrote down all of my court case down on paper, when things happened and how they happened with the dates and the times and what I've been going through for the last couple of years under these false allegations to give to someone who will listen to me whenever that happens. So I also wrote God a thank you note here, and I just did a couple of things. And one of them is that I got to see that person that I knew from church a long time ago. And I got to pray with her. She prayed for me. I prayed for myself. And she laid hands on me in jail. And it just meant so much that I had her love and support. And she's going to put me on her prayer request at her church. So that was very nice to hear from her. And I thank God for that. I also thank God that I got to lead Bible study the first time I was in jail on a Friday night. I had only been there not even 24 hours, and I was leading the Bible study group in my cell. I also got to see a friend from high school that I hadn't seen in many, many years. She was one of my best friends in junior high. We had lunch together. We got to spend a lot of time together. We had classes together. And we did choir and musicals together, so we got to reminisce and talk about life and what got us to jail. And I still get to talk to her now. And so we got to rekindle that relationship and that friendship that we had. So I said, thank you, God, for that. Prayed for, this is something silly that I wrote down, but I prayed for paper to write on and to write my prayers on and to read. And then it wasn't even a couple hours later, I received this yellow notebook with all this paper and a pencil and all this and a Bible. So I was able to write down my thoughts, and that's an answer prayer. I mean, it was very, very simple, but I needed something to keep my mind going while I was sitting there, and God provided, you know, once again. And then I said, thank you, God, that I got to lead in singing at church in jail. And so I wrote all those down, answer prayers, and giving thanks to God, even in the midst of sitting in jail. I also got this in the folder. It's peace, glory to God in the highest, and earth, peace, goodwill toward men, Luke 2:14. And it's just a little card. So got that. And then again, on my folder here, I wrote John 3:16, lay it all at the cross. Be still and know that I am God. Psalms 46:10. I drew the three crosses that Jesus had died on right there, that middle one. And then again, my marriage vows, let love and faithfulness never leave you, bind them around your neck, Write them on the tablet of your heart, Proverbs 3:3. And then inside I said, forgive them. And on this side I said, you're a good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I said, thank you, Jesus. And then love like God. And then on the back, I did ABCs of salvation. Admit you're a sinner. Repent of your sins. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then I put, I don't belong here. And then an arrow. Be separate of this world and transformed by the Holy Spirit. And then I put the dates of jail. And I never put the end date. But I can take my little tiny pencil right now. And I can say I was out on the 11th. So I went in on the 5th of September and I was out on the 11th, 2024. So I am keeping track of when I went to jail. And, like I said, I will go over these Bible study notes when I do another video, and I will go over the Bible and the devotional with you when we do that video. And, so I think that's about it for this video. And I want to just be encouraging to you guys. You know, this is part of my journey. I just said I would share it with you. And so I went to jail and I did my time and I sat there and worshiped God the whole time. I made a lot of friends in jail. And some women who really needed a friend, some women who don't know Jesus Christ, and they don't understand why I am the way I am, and why I don't do drugs, why I don't have any tattoos, why I don't smoke, why I don't live in this world. But I got to be a witness in jail, and so everything happens for a reason, I believe. I believe I was married when I was married for a reason. I married the person that, I married for a reason. And I know that I believed that my husband was a Christian. I believed that we were equally yoked, and it was through my divorce I found out we weren't. And so I need to, be that witness in my life, no matter what is happening in my life. Whether people come in my life or go out of my life, I still need to be me. And that is a Christian single mom. So I hope this is encouraging for you. Thank you guys so much for watching. God bless. Have a great night. Bye.